अनाश्रित कर्मफलं कार्यं कर्म करोति यहा सह सन्यासी च योगी च न निरग्निर् न चाक्रियः. राइट एट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द सिक्स्थ चैप्टर ध्यान योग कृष्णा गिव्स अ क्लियर डेफिनेशन ऑफ हू अ योगी इज. सो हू इज अ योगा रूढ़. राइट एट द बिगिनिंग of sixth chapter, Krishna says, Krishna defines the yogi, anashrita karma phalam karyam karma karoti yaha saha sanyasi cha yogi cha na niragnir cha na nachakriyaha, he says. Who is the sanyasi? A sanyasi and a yogi are one and the same, he says. There is no difference between a sanyasi and a yogi. He says, who is such a yogi? Not the one who has renounced performance of works, performance of doing one's duty, performance of Vedic injunctions, yajñas and so on. A yogi is one who has renunciation as the foundation of the actions that he performs. He is not the one who has renounced actions. That is the reason why he says, anashrita karma palam. Anashrita. Anashrita means one who has no dependence. No dependence, no emotional attachment, no dependence on karma phala, on the fruits of one's actions. No dependence on the rewards, on the experiences that are expected in the future. Essentially, one who is not constantly rooted in expectation of the future. Anashrita karma phalam karyam karma karotiyaha. Karyam karma karotiyaha. One without any expectations whatsoever, without any selfish desires, one who performs, continues to perform actions, one who focuses on actions and not on the consequences. Attention on the action, not on the consequences. The moment we say one is attentive to actions, you know, we all know that most often our work is not productive because of the lack of cooperation of our mind. Our work, we say, our work is not productive because we are absent-minded. But in reality, our work becomes non-productive not because the mind is absent, but because the mind is not in the present. That is the fundamental problem. And this phrase, absent-minded, is also mistaken. What is absent-mindedness? Absent-minded means not that the mind is absent. The mind is always there. Absent-minded is absence of control on the mind, not absence of the mind itself. And since the mind is the medium through which we interact with the world, the mind can do two things. Either it can assist in this process or it can interfere. Most often, it only interferes. When it assists, then our attention is always on what we want. But when it interferes, which means when we cannot control it, it starts to interpret in its own way and it distracts and diverts us. So when Krishna says, anashrita karma palam karyam karma karoti yaha, when there are no mental cravings, when the mind is not hijacked by desires, when there are no thoughts that are bombarding the mind, when one is not controlled by the mind, when one controls the mind, then one can attend to one's work without any focus or without any distraction on expectation of the results, dependence on the results, dependence on the consequences. So such a person, Krishna says, is a yogi. He is a yoga ruda. Now Krishna is now, what he talked what he covered as Sita Prajna in the second chapter, now he goes to add some more elements. Primarily Vairagya, renunciation is going to add to Jnana. Sita Prajna was primarily focused on the Jnana side of things. Now add to Jnana, Krishna is adding the component of Vairagya. And now he is going to talk about what Vairagya is all about. What is sannyasa? That is why he says sannyasi and a yogi are one and the same. There is no difference, he says. One should not confuse that a sannyasi is different, a yogi is different. And he builds on that and he says, yam sannyasam iti prahuhu yogam tam viddhi pandava nahi asanyasta sankalpaha yogi bhavati kaschana. Now he is talking about what is this sannyasa? Yes, sannyasamiti prahuku yogam tam viddhi pandava. Hey Pandava, understand that renunciation is yoga, he says. Renunciation, vairagya is yoga. Which means karma yoga is founded. The foundation is renunciation. And what is this renunciation? It is not about giving up worldly things. It is giving up worldly thinking. Giving up worldly things is impractical. Many a times, we may try and give up worldly things, but the mental cravings can remain strong. So there is no use in giving up worldly things. No use giving up worldly things and also trying to change without addressing the mental cravings. You know, there was this man who was a travel agent and whose job was to do bookings. And he was doing this for several years. And all that he knew in life was only this. And he was programmed to do this. And one fine day he decided, enough is enough. I will retire, I will go and join an ashram in Rishikesh. So he goes there and he tries to adjust to the life of an ashram. And after a few days, eventually settles to be a booking agent in the ashram. Now there is no difference to what he was doing before and what he is doing now, because mentally he has not changed. His mental makeup remained the same. So whether he was at his hometown or whether he went to Rishikesh in an ashram did not make any impact whatsoever. His mental makeup did not undergo reprogramming. So renunciation here is renouncing worldly thinking, renouncing worldly thoughts. So Krishna says, yam sannyasam iti prahuhu yogam tam viddhi pandava. So know that renunciation is yoga. And he says, nahi asanyasta sankalpaha yogi bhavati kaschana. Here, sanyasta sankalpaha. Sankalpa here is delusion, body mind delusion. Thinking that I am the body. Thinking, mistaken identity. So, only when one renounces this delusory thinking, one can become a yogi. So Krishna here says, if one does not renounce this delusory thinking, one cannot become a yogi. To become, here yogi is a karmanishta, yoga rudha. There is no point on attempting to do many things when the fundamental requirement is to give up this delusory thinking that I am not this body. Because everything, the cause of attachment is this delusory thinking that I am this body. And Krishna says, what is renunciation? The fundamental definition here is renouncing this delusory thinking that I am the body. Yogi bhavati kaschana. And then Krishna goes on and then he says, aruroksor muner yogam karma karana muchyate yogarudasya tasyeva samah karana muchyate. Now he is defining the yoga rudha. Aruroksor munir yogam karmam karana muchyate. योगारूढस्य तस्यैव समः कारणमुच्यते. द होल प्रोसेस ऑफ कर्मयोगा इज अबाउट reaching a stage of atmasakshatkara, and that is the state of a yoga rudha, that is the state of a sthita prajna, that is the state of a gunatita. Until then Krishna is categorical. There is no question of renouncing one's actions. Until then, sannyasa is renouncing expectation of rewards, not renouncing action per se, not renouncing duty. After one reaches that stage, then one has a choice. Krishna only says one has a choice of renouncing actions as well. Which means one can then remain without performing actions in a state of samadhi. But then later he also adds that even those who have reached the stage, for the sake of larger good, need to engage in activity and actions and performing duties in order to set an example for others to follow. So here Krishna introduces the Yogarudha is the one who has reached the pinnacle of Atmasakshatkara by the practice of Karma Yoga. But jnana and karma, vairagya coming together in the form of karma yoga, enabling one to reach a state of atmasakshatkara. What is the definition of a yoga rudha? Just like how Krishna defined sthita prajna in the second chapter. Prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan atmanyevatmana tushtaha sthita prajnas tadochyate. He is giving a similar definition for a yoga rudha. Yadahi na indriyarteshu na karmashu anusajjate sarvasankalpa sanyasi yogarudas tadochyate. Who is a yogaruda? Who is called a yogaruda? One, yadahi na indriyarteshu na karmashu anusajjate. What is anusajjate? Total detachment, lack of attachment. One who is completely detached, completely not attached to indriyarteshu, objects of senses, sense objects, the matter, the world of matter, na karmashu, and also not attached to his actions as well. He is a yogarudha. That's the definition. Similar definition as to sthita prajna. The one who is completely detached from his actions and from all the sense objects of senses, and such a person, yogarudha, sarva sankalpa sanyasi yogarudas tadochyate. He is a sarva sankalpa sanyasi. What is sarva sankalpa? We said sankalpa here is the body mind delusion, and sarva sankalpa, all the cravings, all the desires, all the thoughts that emanate from this misidentity are covered by this phrase sarva sankalpa. Sarva sankalpa sannyasi. Sannyasi here is one who has renounced. One who has renounced all kinds of cravings, all kinds of selfish desires, all kinds of activities that are driven by selfish desires. Sarva sankalpa sannyasi. Such a person is yogarudha. Now such a yogarudha, Krishna closes the topic of yogarudha with the very famous shloka. How does a yogarudha uplift himself? The formula Krishna gives in the next shloka. Uddharet atmanatmanam na atmanam avasadayet atmaiva hyatmano banduhu atmaiva ripuratmanaha. The yogarudha is one who understands this very clearly. What is his understanding? One can uplift oneself by one's mind. It is the mind which is detached from the world that uplifts the Atman. The same mind, when it is attached to the world, pulls the Atman down into samsara. The same mind can be liberating in nature, can help in liberation. The same mind can also end up help also be instrumental for our bondage. So Yoga Rudha is one who understands that it is the mind which is an instrument that has that needs to be used for one's own upliftment. Now he also understands that the mind can be one's greatest friend or the mind can be one's greatest enemy. So the question here needs to be asked, how do we treat the mind? Or rather, how does a Yoga Rudha treat the mind? Now, can the mind be treated as a friend? Can the mind be treated as an enemy? If we treat the mind as an enemy, let's see what happens. Then let's every thought that pops up to the mind, let's say, becomes our enemy. If we start treating it as an enemy, then we become like a soldier on a battleground on a 24/7 duty, constantly fighting against these enemies, which are endless. So after a while, we are depleted, fatigued, completely distressed and zoned out. So therefore, treating the mind just as an enemy is not easy, it's not practical. Now if we treat mind as a friend, and if every thought that pops up is treated in a friendly manner, we also will soon realize that these thoughts will deceive us and may even destroy us. So treating a mind as a friend is also not a great proposition. Now, a sthita prajna or a yoga rudha is supposed to be one, as per Krishna's definition, is one who has mastered one's mind. By mastering one's mind, by cultivating equanimity, one can perform right actions. Krishna also defines what is a right action, what is a skillful action. Skillful action, Krishna's definition, is a very profound definition. Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. Buddhiyukto jahatiha ubhe sukrata dushkrute tasmat yogaya yujasva yoga karmasu kaushalam. One buddhiyuktaha, one who has equanimity of mind, one who has mastered the mind, and with employing a mastered mind, one discards sukruta dushkruta, good and bad. And one engages in performing actions, and when such an engagement happens, such an action becomes skillful in nature. Such an action becomes right action. So a sthita prajna, yoga rudha, and a gunatita as well can perform such a skillful action. But the question that arises is, should this mind that needs to be mastered, do we treat it as a friend or as an enemy? Now, with the understanding of a sthita prajna, with an understanding of a yoga rudha, with the understanding of gunatita, which we are going to see, we will not get a complete answer. That is the reason why we also need the understanding of a jnani, the supreme bhakta, which by connecting all of this, our perspective becomes clear. Why? The answer that eventually Krishna gives is, do not treat the mind as a friend, do not treat the mind as an enemy, treat it as a patient. Treat it as a patient. And we ask, how do I treat it as a patient? You treat it as a patient by taking it to the right doctor. And when this patient is given away to be taken care of by the right doctor, only then it can be mastered. And only that person who, recognizing this, gives the right treatment to this mind, he becomes a jnani. And what we are going to see, the reason why we went back to understanding Sthita Prajna, understanding Yoga Rudha before diving deep into the characteristic of Gunatita, is Gunatita is developing on the characteristics of a Sthita Prajna and a Yoga Rudha. A Yoga Rudha and a Sthita Prajna put together is a Gunatita, but eventually we will see all of this put together becomes a Jnani. And as Krishna said, the one who is the most dear to him is a Jnani, the Supreme Bhakta. So this is where we will see, in while he goes into, while when we dive into understanding a Gunatita, the way he concludes, we will see that all of this are brought together, the Sthita Prajna, the Yoga Rudha and Gunatita, to say ultimately one has to become a Jnani. And who is a Jnani? He is the Supreme Bhakta. And we will see that next week as we start relishing the characteristics of a Gunatita.
Sarvam Sri Krishna Arpanamastu.